Welcome to this new episode of Ask Stago, the podcast dedicated to provide expert answers to your expert question in hemostasis. I am Cécile Urquet, and I'm really glad to be here again with you, Audrey Carlo, to co-host this new episode. Today, we will be answering some questions we received from Italy around one topic. Is there an APTT reagent that can fit all purposes for the APTT testing?
And to cover this question today, I am happy to welcome Thomas Flohr. Thomas is today a product line manager at Stago BNL, and previously he was in the field as application specialist. With a strong scientific background, Thomas is always committed at providing the most educated and rational answers to any question and has developed quite some expertise around APTT topics that we cover today. Hello, Thomas.
Hello. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. Hello, Thomas. So we like to start with the basic here. So can you remind us what is an APTT and what type of applications covers the SA?
Of course. Well, APTT stands for activated partial prothrombin time. It is one of the three pillars of coagulation daily testing with prothrombin time and fibrinogen measurement.
And when you say it is one of the tests performed routinely in the coagulation laboratory, it is because APTT can be abnormal in many clinical situations and thus can be useful to early detect them or screening.
This is true, Audrey. There are many possible applications for the APTT testing as it is a global coagulation assay. We activate coagulation with silica, kaolin, ellagic acid, polyphenols, which start the coagulation process from factor 12 activation into factor 12A. APTT thus screens for the functionality of factors 12, 11, 9, 8, 10, 5, 2, and fibrinogen.
This is what we call the endogenous pathway. Is it correct to say that APTT will detect any defect in all those factors?
I would not say any defect, as it should not detect small defects in endogenous factors. To avoid also unnecessary investigations in just a small but non-pathological factor decrease. Therefore, Seela's IH47A2 clarifies this by saying that an APTT reagent has to detect an endogenous coagulation factor that is below 30%. However, deficiencies lower than 45% should also be detectable, but not for higher activity levels.
And Thomas, maybe you can tell us more in which clinical situations APTT cladding time can be abnormal, knowing that sometimes the APTT prolongation can be isolated and sometimes it's combined with PT or fibrinogen abnormalities, if we come back to these first-line coagulation assays.
Sure. Well, a so-called isolated prolongation of the APTT is encountered when the factors investigated by only the APTT are abnormal. This isolated APTT prolongation can be due to a congenital deficiency in factor 8, factor 9, factor 11, and factor 12, but some far less frequent deficiencies in factor 12 cofactors, prekallikrein, and high molecular weight kininogen can also prolong the APTT. Finally, some other congenital perturbations like von Willebrand type 2N can also affect this clotting time.
And here you mentioned congenital deficiencies, but I'm sure that there are also some acquired deficiencies linked to clinical situations.
Of course. Here you can think about liver disease or consumptive coagulopathies, which will induce a decrease in endogenous factor levels. But you can also have other conditions like circulating anticoagulants, be it lupus anticoagulant type or anti-factor antibodies, or some anticoagulation treatment like heparin or thrombin inhibitors.
And actually, we already said during our season one that the APTT is sometimes used to monitor heparin treatment, and its usefulness for proper monitoring was quite debated, actually. But however, has a screening assay APTT needs to detect it? And so, can you maybe tell us how to assess the sensitivity of an APTT reagent to heparin and endogenous factors?
The procedure is quite clear as detailed in Seela's IH47A2. Dilutions of assayed normal plasma pool or reference plasma with the appropriate factor deficient plasma are made to achieve factor levels between below 1% to 100%. Those samples are then measured and the APTT clotting times are plotted against factor levels in percent. The threshold of factor sensitivity is defined as the extrapolated value of factor level from which APTT meets the upper limit of the reference range. According to CLSI H47A2, this threshold should be obtained for a factor level between 30 and 45%.
And a good way here to check for your experiment is to verify that your 100% activity sample achieves an APTT clutching time close to the mean of the reference range you've determined locally. Of course, if the reference range follows a Gaussian distribution.
True. Then talking about sensitivity to heparin, actually you assess how wide is your APTT clotting time range versus one set of samples that cover the therapeutic range. The sample principle of dose response is applied, but rather than serial dilutions or spiking experiments with infractionated heparin, it is advised to use samples from individual heparinized patients.
And we should maybe say that this sensitivity to heparin, and especially the definition of the APTT therapeutic range, has to be done for each batch of reagents.
This is true. But if we consider the sensitivity to heparin, the wider the clotting time range for a therapeutic range, the more sensitive to heparin your assay is. For example, we know that kaolin-based activators are not as sensitive as silica-based ones.
And Thomas, you also mentioned earlier that the APTT assays are sensitive to inhibitors such as lupus anticoagulant. We recall from our episode with Dizaganon around lupus anticoagulant diagnosis that it is quite complex and there is one APTT pathway in this chart. Can you tell us something about it?
What I can tell is that APTT reagents significantly differ in their sensitivity to lupus anticoagulant. But when you say, Audre, there is an APTT pathway for lupus anticoagulant diagnosis, of course this is true. Yet, often the reagents most sensitive to LA are not that sensitive to endogenous factor deficiencies, for example. In addition, it's not recommended to use lupus-designated APTT reagent for routine screening purposes.
So, a good balance should be found to detect any situation properly with your APTT. Is this even possible?
Of course, everyone is looking for the perfect APTT assay that is sensitive to all clinical settings. But the biochemical interaction between the activator in the APTT reagent and the proteins in the plasma results in tests with different sensitivities. For example, we know that kaolin-based reagents are the most sensitive to factors, but less to heparin. And we know that some APTT with different phospholipid preparation are very sensitive to LA, but not to factor deficiencies or heparin.
And so, Thomas, if I understand well, you are basically saying that at the moment it's not possible to have a one-for-all-purposes APTT reagent?
What I'm saying is that every activator has their own particular sensitivity, depending on the biochemical status of the plasma. But of course, the clinicians make educated choices based on literature they read, scientific clinical outcomes reported, and most of all, to clinical settings they might actually meet in their practice. As Lawrence Rosen wrote in 2013, the idea is often to go for a compromise if the choice is to have one APTT reagent.
So in other words, making the risk-benefit balance of each asset depending maybe on the patient population receiving the lab or your hospital.
Precisely. And so far, we've not even talked about the influences from non-hemostatic pathological states that can influence the APTT. States where elevated factor VIII and elevated C-reactive protein can shorten or prolong clotting times respectively.
And we may also refer to an additional purpose of APTT reagent. It's used for factor assays and factor level measurements. We know for new hemophilia treatment that it becomes more and more tricky to get proper reagents that will be appropriate for any molecule, recombinant factors, pegylated ones, etc.
Yeah, and we cannot even say that, for example, silica-based reagents are the best for monitoring this type of treatment, because from studies like the one published by Mirella Esbon in 2020, we see that this is not only something that correlates to type of activator that is used. Therefore, careful consideration of whether the activator can be used to accurately monitor patients under recombinant factor treatment is important.
I have the feeling that we may come back to this topic to develop some part more in depth in the near future. Thank you, Thomas, for having shared a bit of your knowledge with us and our listeners today. It is now time to close this episode. Thank you all for listening. And as usual, all literature sources are listed in the podcast description, along with the link to the previous Ask Stago episode we referred to today. And please feel free to send us any question that you may have at our email address, ask@stago.com. We'll be glad to answer to it in the next episode. Don't forget to follow us on LinkedIn, on Twitter to be informed of the new episode, and see you next time.
This podcast is brought to you by Stago. Diagnostics is in our blood.